So I'm here to talk about the neuromorphic computings that leverage emerging devices. Particularly today, I'm going to talk about the emerging resistive device. I'm Helene from University of Pittsburgh. So for more information of our research, you can reference our website of ei-lab.org. Okay. So in past 2 days, we have been talking a lot about the neuromorphic computations, neuromorphic systems. So I guess it's no doubt that this is the directions we're trying to work on. And in fact, a lot of efforts has been put. For instance, I give some examples, at least at the chip levels, to demonstrate what we have done on this path. Okay. So if we're looking into that, there are some common features of all these implementations. Basically, people trying to implement the synapse and the neurons on chip. Okay. And then we are able to integrate the processing and the storage all together to realize the high-level parallelism operation and the large-scale storage. However, all these approaches, extreme approaches, okay, they all implement by CMOS technologies. And in fact, the scale, the number of the neurons and the number of the synapse on chips are limited because of the CMOS technology. So our research is trying to say, okay, can we leverage the emerging technologies to further boost the on-chip ability. Okay, so the example I will give here is about the memory stores. Since the rediscovery in 2008 about the memory store technologies, okay, at early stage people realized the device itself has a high similarity as the synapse in biologic systems. For instance, on the right of here, this is devices tested in HP labs. Our students are sitting over there doing the testing and measurement results. So basically what we find that if we carefully programming those devices, we can obtain multi-level cells, multi-level of resistance states, or even close to analog states. Okay. So another observation is memory store crossbar. Crossbar can be taken as we have one layer of mantles and another layer of mantles. Okay, they are on horizontal and vertical directions. So at cross point, okay, every cross point there is a memory store device. So such kind of structure can realize very high density storage and operation. But more importantly, I illustrate that bottom of the slice. Okay, such kind of structures is very nature for the matrix operation. The matrix operation looks on the left. So basically input vectors through the matrix at output, each term represents a summation of the weighted input vectors. So for memory store crossbar arrays, if we taking the input, if we transfer the input vector to the voltage on the left side and collecting the current at the bottom of the neurons, okay, so the current at each bit lines is kind of the gated or the weighted function of the input voltage. And the weight is represented by the conductance of the memory store devices. This is very high level conceptual. So there's a lot of non-ideal situations need to be considered in circuit simulation and realization. But conceptually, the synapse network has very high similarity at memory store crossbar. And this is the foundation of our work. So a couple of years ago, we initiated work, and we start with the brain state in a box. So basically, it's abstract models for brain functions for pattern associations, and can be done training in the recall. The recall function, for instance, essentially is a matrix and vector operations. So we have an input vectors. So through multiple iterations, okay, so supposedly it all goes to some corner or converge to a positive and negative ones. So we did early evaluations to say how can we implement such kind of structures through memory store crossbars. For instance, in these structures, we can supply the input vectors as in voltage level to the crossbar arrays. And in these algorithms, original software algorithms, the matrix has a positive and negative values. And the memory store crossbar, memory store devices is in physical devices, so we only can supply the positive value. So in the work, we separate it into two matrix So one is used to represent the positive and one is to represent the negative value conceptually. But in reality, we just do the subtractions and get the real value. It doesn't have to be the positive and negative terms. So at the end of the crossbars, we can utilize in summing op amps to perform the analog operations for addition, subtraction, so on and so forth. And the result will go through the comparators to say, okay, the each term, are they converged or not yet? Shall we send it back to the input of the crossbars for further iteration? Such kind of a structures, so this is for the recall functionality. One most important thing for the crossbar or the work we are doing is for the trainings. So training circuit implementation actually is wrapped atop of the recall functionality. So what we do is have this pattern selections and the most important is the training circuits to detect the training signal, to generate the training signals and then utilizing the arbiters to select the input patterns. So in hardware implementations, one of the difficult we find, or one of the differences from algorithm level is, at algorithm level, for instance, if we're doing the original delta rules, okay, so people expect, or people has precise information for the input vectors, have precise information for the expected, the target output, and computed the outputs. Okay, and the people can do the complex computations to get precise the delta, the change of the weight for each term. Okay, so in hardware implementation, first of all, it is very difficult to get the precise information for the input and output vectors. Even we say, okay, we can do the detections, multi-level op-amp design is very costly. And secondly, obtain the exactly value of the memristor crossbar is difficult. Considering all the non-ideal situations, the value you read out could be very different, not very different, at least slightly different from the real physical value in the crossbar. So we're trying to reduce the cost of hardware implementation. So what we proposed is, okay, instead to get all the precise informations, what we do is to detect the polarity of the difference of the output vectors, the polarity of the input vectors, and use as to decide, so shall we increase or decrease the weighting in the matrix? Okay, and in this process, we only to increase or decrease slightly. So basically, the iteration will take longer. But considering this is hardware implementation, so each iteration is much faster. So we kind of trade off the hardware implementation cost versus performance to make it work. So we use BSB for the pattern recognizations. So in the work, we use the particular for the character recognizations. So for instance, for character A, we have 25 different type shape for the training. And then for each characters, we train and dot BSB models. Then for any input defect or not defect, it submit to all the BSB models. So whoever had fast convergences, we take it as the best result or the best estimations. Okay. And here's here is the results we got for the ideal input patterns and the patterns with the defects. So basically, if we in the chart, the ideal represent the results without considering any process variation or noises, and the yellow bar represent impact of the process variation and noise. So considering the time constraints, very simple summaries. What we find very interesting is the impact of the process variations, in fact, is very limited. Because when you do the trainings, okay, it's already limited or absorbed the impact of the process variations. However, if there's any dynamic noise generated during the circuit operation, this is unpredictable. And the majority of the difference of the yellow from the blue coming from the dynamic noise. Well, so afterwards, we actually continued our works in trying to develop the circuits. At the circuit approaches, we believe there's at least two possibilities. One is the possibility we call the level-based design. Basically here, what we have is, if there's any input vectors, like 3-bit input vectors, we translate through DAC to some analog voltage levels. And you utilize this analog voltage levels, go through crossbar and collect this current translate to voltage level. So this is the conceptual structure I presented previously. So such kind of structures is compatible to the existing signal processings, but we realize that the and this is good for the high performance computation, but we realize that the hardware cost probably is very high. So another approach is what we call the spiking based designs. So basically, the input vectors is translate number of the spikes and go through the crossbars. And at the end of the bit lines, we have the integrated file circuits to generate the output of the spikes. So the approach is kind of a more close to the biological understandings. The advantage of such kind of approach is it's very high power efficiency. So in our labs, we do the circuit implementation and investigation for both approach. And here, I'm going to show some results for the spiking computations only. Here's our circuit. So ideally, conceptually, what we expect is the number of your output spikes shall be proportional or has a linear functionality as the gated input vectors. Okay. However, during the designs, we find this is not true. So in the simulations, as you can see, N, capital N equals to something, N represent a maximum spikes for each operation. So what we find that this is kind of a get saturated. It increases and then gets saturated. So this is not very ideal linear functionality. So basically, if you're looking into the circuit structures, what we find is there are two major impacts. One of the major impacts is the integrated file circuit delay overhead. So know that the circuit itself is not ideal. It requires some response time. For instance, in our IFC circuit designs, its response time takes 400 to 1500 picoseconds. So even so, that's why in the designs we see this saturation. So even I have a more big, if we have a bigger current inject into that, the output circuit couldn't generate more spikes because of the constraint. Another observation is the bit line charging efficiency. So here's the bit lines. So when we have charging the bit lines, okay, as the bit line voltage increases, the charging efficiency actually decreases. So this results the observation of this. So even I have the same input sigma G and the pulse numbers, sometimes it's have a positive and negative one pulse differences because of the charging efficiency difference. We try to implement the overall circuits. So here I show a very simple example for feed-forward circuits. So basically, we're utilizing 32 by 12 memristor crossbar arrays to recognize the six different patterns. And this is the training functions, the results. And then when we input different characters through the arrays, okay, so it's expect to generate the spikes. So in this designs, we again utilize in two columns to represent one characters. So one is represent excitation part and one columns represent inhibition part. Okay. I think one of the difficulty in our work, in fact, is to optimize and verify the functionality of our work. So a circuit design is more accurate, but it's very slow. So what we do is trying to utilize, develop the MATLAB flows for algorithm and evaluation tests. So at each levels, we are able to develop the correlations between the algorithm levels versus circuit design levels. So in this ways, we are able to run a lot of verifications for the circuit functionality. And right now we are working very hard for the neural chip design tape out, and it's scheduled on the August 2015, a couple of months. This is our work on the circuit designs, and we also interested on the system development, what we can do with those structures. So there's tons of different options in circuit development, and people are kind of doing all of this. We're kind of trying to compare the advantage and disadvantage of different approaches, and certainly we work on the memristor-based reconfigurable designs. Just for information, even for the neural acceleration itself, what we're trying to do is do the FPGA exploration as well in our lab. We're utilizing the Congo systems supported by DARPA projects. And one example is recurrent neural network-based language models. So compare the CPU, GPU, and FPGA implementations. The FPGA implementations, what we're trying to do is develop the process elements and mimic the networks of the connections, generic network connections, and try out the RN network. So it's up to 160 times of runtime savings, and power and energy consumption is 60 times improvement. However, we can see that it's still a lot of things to do, and we still are not very pleased by the results. Basically, we find that so far, even we implement the process neural process elements, the overall system is still developed on the Neumann architecture. For instance, the memory bandwidth is still the biggest difficulty in this implementation. So what we're trying to propose is called neuromorphic computing acceleration, NCA. So hardware-wise, what we're trying to develop is many, many memories across bars, and the crossbar arrays are grouped by what we call the MBC groups. Okay? So from the CPU, it can submit some tasks through the queues, and through the DACs, it goes to memory crossbars. So in these structures, we're trying to maintain all the operations, computations in analog format. So the operation will, let me see this first. Basically, at higher software levels, what we find that it's difficult to, currently we do not have any platform to recognize what we can do on the neural accelerators and what we cannot do on the neural accelerators. So we develop a compiler that to recognize what we can translate the source original code to the neural topologies, and then do the compilations and send it to the NCA or the executables. So during the executions, we first spread the control signals, basically say, okay, these signals, input signals shall go to which crossbar arrays, and how long would that stay over there, what's the following stage, and the data will remain that analog formats during the computation. What we tend to do is this DAC and the ADC is very, very costly. So we only maintain that at the boundary of the accelerator. The overall systems is mixed signals, means control is in digital format and computation is in analog format. The work was evaluated at architecture levels. We select a couple of classification applications on purpose, because we do not have the sufficient computation powers to do a lot of more comparisons. But just for such kind of comparisons, we compare with the digital neural process elements implementation, and then we compare with the memristor-based crossbar plus the digital NOC implementations. So you can see that the performance and energy consumptions are significantly improved, and classification rate is kind of decorated, because in these simulations we consider the process variations as well as the noise impacts. I assume like 90% is still a good number at the stage. Well, the last thing I want to talk is about the design flows. So people kind of right now assume like we have everything, okay, but how do we use that? Is it transparent to users? Any user can design such kind of circuits. Of course, this is very hard. So we observe that in practical neural networks, usually has very large scales, but the connection is kind of a sparse. For the memory crossbar, at current stage, we are not able to realize like 10,000 by 10,000 crossbar arrays. It's highly impossible now, it's highly impossible in a couple of years. And the connections at high wires is kind of fixed. So how can we reduce the differences in the model? Well, we find that the connection overhead between multiple crossbars, in fact, generate a lot of intermediate neurons, which is not, this is not the favorable in the design. And also what we find that the sparsity kind of reduced utilization of the crossbars. So recently we start working on the cluster connections to multi-dense crossbars. The basic idea here is since the direct mapping of a neural network can induce very high hardware cost. For instance, on the left is the example of the neural network. Red dot represent the neurons and the blue lines represent connections. So if it's just a map to crossbars, it's horrible. But there's a lot of empty place connections in the crossbar arrays. So what we're trying to do is we do the classifications to increase crossbar utilization. So we basically observe like among all these neurons, are they some connections based on the algorithms or applications? And we're trying to group them. And those groups can be translated to small scale of the crossbars. And we can do such kinds of iterations. After a couple of iterations, we kind of partition the overall design into small pieces. This is our very preliminary results. So basically, you can see on the left top with the iterations, the number of connections not in, not within the crossbars kind of decreases until it's only a couple of, or a few number of the connections. And secondly, on the bar figures over here is basically saying, okay, originally we assume that all the implementations has to be done by 64 by 64 crossbar arrays. And after doing this, we can significantly reduce the size of the crossbar arrays, which in fact improved the robustness of the design. This is kind of the placement and routing results. It's still very rough at the stage, but this is generally give the information like how many crossbars we need and how big it is in the implementation. And here is usually the how conjunctive or relaxed of the signal connections. So basically we want signal routing is less while the size of the crossbar arrays is smaller. So I mean due to the time constraints here, we just give the very simple examples. What we believe is these new devices, not only the memory crossbar arrays, but a lot of new devices already triggered the rebirth of the neuromorphic circuit designs. Well, from a hardware designer perspective, I believe holistic schemes that integrating the device, the circuit, architecture, design automation, compiler, so on and so forth, all these efforts have to be considered at the design stage. For the given examples, I couldn't, I do not have enough time to talk a lot of details, but if you're interested, I'm happy to offer our papers and discussions. So at the end, I use Dr. Kuswell's sentence to conclude the presentation. I imagine the world where the difference between man and machine blurs, where the difference between humanity and technology fades, where the soul and silicon chips unite. And I would like to thank all lab members, our students that were here. So Professor Chen, Ian Chen and me led EI Lab at University of Pittsburgh. Right now we have about 27 PhD students, one postdocs, and a couple of visiting faculty members. Yeah. Any questions?